right now is Richard Hauer, and with me is Clint Muhlfeld, and we'll be presenting a series of descriptors of our work, both past and as we press on into the future. What we're doing is, or what we will be doing here is first describing a little bit about our research site, some of the attributes of it, and then we're going to go into some of the past threats to the system. Particularly, I'm going to be focusing on the coal mining that has just come to closure, we hope. Then I'm going to turn things over to Clint, and he's going to be talking about some of his joint research that we have going where he is taking the lead. So, first of all, the Crown of the Continent ecosystem is really a remarkable place. And I know that I'm talking to folks that are outside the Flathead region, but basically what we are talking about, when we talked about the Crown of the Continent, is a region that is located in northwest Montana, extending from an area that's just south of the Bob Marshall and Great Bear Wilderness Complex area, located in this area up through Glacier Park and extending up into Canada. So it's this whole region just to the east of Flathead Lake and incorporates all of the Flathead Basin as well as areas that are to the east and to the north. One of the things that's very remarkable about this particular place, and that is that it is a focal point of species mixtures from various northern and southern Rocky Mountain species, as well as species from the prairies and the maritime. And the reason for this is because there are three major drainages of the North American continent together in one place, Glacier Park, and that's called Triple Divide Peak, and it was from that Crown of the Continent name. What I'll be talking about first is the Transboundary Flathead, and our research is currently focused very strongly there. And what we call the Transboundary Flathead is that portion that is in the, also known as the North Fork, and that extends well up into the southeast portion of British Columbia, and then makes up the western side, and also the river makes up the west boundary of Glacier Park. One of the things I want to bring to folks' attention is a piece that Clint and I wrote last year that appeared in Science, and we would be delighted to send this to anyone as a PDF file if you'll send us an email with a request. So this particular piece appeared where the point is, as you can tell from the title, Compelling Science Saves a River Valley, in which we are making the argument that the science established the backbone around which resolute policy and relentless political pressure was able to be brought to bear. And the things that I'm going to be talking about immediately following, basically what we saw was that the natural goods and services that are provided by a World Heritage Site and a biosphere reserve were ultimately valued more than the commodities of natural resource extraction. 35 years of coal mining threat has been in what we call the transboundary. And here in this red line is just the North Fork drainage in the Crown of the Continent. And many of you are familiar with the Lewis overthrust belt that occurs throughout Glacier National Park and into the northern part of the Great Bear Wilderness. And that's the geological formations that give Glacier Park its, you know, strong geological character. Just to the north of that are Cretaceous Jurassic area or era geological formations that contain large coal fields that are also part of the base of not only the North Fork, but also part of this larger Crown of the Continent. there has been coal mining taking place in the Elk River drainage, which is just to the north of the Transboundary Flathead. And there's a series of coal mines in the coal fields that are in the Elk Basin. There's also was a proposed coal mine located here in the southern portion of the Crow's Nest coal field that was actually in the Flathead. And the following results come from a study that we conducted specifically to directly compare Elk River and the Flathead River Basin waters. So Elk Valley coal is done through mountaintop removal coal mines, not too dissimilar from the infamous mountaintop coal mining of West Virginia in Eastern Kentucky coal fields. Basically, what it happens is a strip mining operation where the tops of the mountains are removed, bearing or revealing the coal, and the coal is then extracted in with large quantities of overburden placed in various places down in the river valley. Here you'll see a series of five different mines, and what we did is we established a very nice experimental design in which we had five sites above any coal mining in the Flathead and below the proposed mine, so that if the mine didn't come into place, we could look long-term and see what the after mining effects were. But both of these are without any mining. Within the Elk Basin, we had a series of sites that were above the mines, and then a series of sites that were located below the mining. What I'm going to show you now is a series of data, you know, of water chemistry, as well as aquatic life that is comparing the Flathead Basin site to the Elk Basin site. Here is within Flathead Basin, these are 10 different locations. On the right are those that are above the proposed mine. On the right are below the proposed mine. As you can see, note that the mean concentrations are less than 10 micrograms per liter. That's micrograms per liter is parts per billion. This is nitrate concentrations in the Elk Basin. Right. Note the change in scale along here. This is now from not from 0 to 10, but now 0 to 3,000 above the mine. The sites for the nitrate concentrations of those sites were virtually identical to those of the Flathead Basin. But notice how extremely high the nitrate values are below the mining. Here's the same suite of data, only with sulfate. All the concentrations remaining below 10 milligrams per liter. And here is in the, and here is in the sulfate in the Elk Basin. Note the change in scale. It's now 0 to 700. So frequently getting well in excess of 100 milligrams per liter, where in the Flathead they're all below 10. And here is for selenium. Note that the concentration scale is from 0 to 1, and in the Elk, you see the same pattern with selenium with effects directly on the water quality of waters in the Elk by comparison to the Elk sites above the mining, and here are the Elk sites below the mining. So clearly, both are in three different areas of water quality, nitrate, sulfate, and selenium. We see a distinct increase, substantial increase in the amount of nitrate, sulfate, and selenium concentration directly as affecting.
I think that means they can't hear us.
Can folks still hear me okay?
Yes, yep. You sound good, yep. Rick.
Okay. On to the effects of this finding on aquatic life, we looked at algae and as well as macroinvertebrate. And in with algae, we collected periphyton, returned it to the laboratory for various kinds of analyses, and looking at biomass periphyton, what we see is much higher mean values as well as a much broader range of standard deviations around those means. That's because it's very patchy. So you end up with some values that are very low, but other values much higher than the flathead. It's not statistically significantly different, but it gives you a general idea of the trends, particularly with a much higher periphyton occurring in the algae, where it's affected by the mining. In terms of species richness, this is really very remarkable. Right at the very base of the food web, we see much higher species richness of algal community in the flathead compared to the elk. So we see a decline in species richness under the effect of mining. Getting into the aquatic insects, collecting aquatic insects from the streams, what we see is in the Elk River a significant decrease in the numbers of stoneflies by comparison to the flathead, not only in terms of numbers, but also in terms of species diversity. These are caddisflies, and again, we see a similar kind of response by both the stoneflies and the caddisflies with significantly decreased numbers of species and numbers of abundance in the Elk River. Note the contrast here. This is mayflies, and what we see here is that two very tolerant to pollution are significantly increasing in abundance as a direct result. Both of these two taxa are algal grazers, and so they are both tolerant and they are responding to the increased algal growth in the elk drainage as a response to the increased nitrogen loading. So, sort of as a wrap on this overall threat that we have been dealing with for the last 5 years in the Flathead or in the North Fork, here is sort of a summary of the results. So, what we see is significantly degraded water quality. We see a significant increase in the selenium from 7 to 10-fold. We see a significant increase in the sulfates from 50 to 100-fold. And a highly significant increase in the nitrate, anywhere from 500 to 1,000-fold in the nitrate. In the aquatic life, what we see is a significant decrease in sensitive species and an increase in tolerant species, all of these things being classical indicators of degradation in the elk basin. And it was based on these data that we were able to make the argument that opening coal mining in the North Fork of the Flathead would degrade water quality down the North Fork, entering into Glacier National Park, and a review by a United Nations UNESCO panel that came and did a review of the research and visited the site. It was their assessment that these mines could not be opened, for this mine and future mines could not be opened in the North Fork without having a direct and deleterious impact and effect on Glacier National Park and then within the context of a World Heritage and Biosphere Reserve. So moving on, this is a stream that flows off of the Continental Divide. This actually is in British Columbia. But the idea here, you know, what we'd like you to think about is aquatic species and within the context of streams of this particular type of flowing down and over and through gravel beds, alluvial aquifer system. So what you see here is a tributary of the North Fork, and even as a tributary, a significant amount of cut and fill alluviation and transport of gravel and the exposure of gravels into large, what we call parafluvial gravel bars that have exposed gravel. And the idea here is that through the transport of these gravels and the movement of the stream across the system, there develops a tremendous amount of groundwater-surface water interaction that promotes not only the species richness of periphyton and algal species, but also the aquatic insects, and promotes the spawning of bull trout and cutthroat trout. One of the things that we are also doing within our research is using remote sensing as a tool for identifying and characterizing these rivers and floodplains. Here is one of the floodplains here in the crown of the continent. And this is using the remotely sensed hyperspectral and multispectral data to do a classification of the terrestrial vegetation, the riparian area. And within that, you'll see that these are not in the classic sense of most GIS, but rather this is done on a pixel-by-pixel basis where we look at the reflectance characteristics, the signatures of different vegetation or attribute types that are on the floodplain, and then we're able to very closely tie the characteristics of the vegetation on the floodplain and within both the parafluvial and orthofluvial zones of the riparian area with the vegetation and be able to characterize those attributes. One of the things also that keeps these systems so open, this is looking over, you'll see here, nearly a 60-year time period, looking at the channel, the primary channel of Flathead River as it flows over this particular floodplain segment. And what you see is a tremendous amount of movement of the river as it is going through cut and fill alluviation and avulsion between 1945 and 2004. And what this does is it sets up a tremendous amount of groundwater surface water interaction, as well as developing a shifting habitat mosaic of vegetation across the surface of the floodplain. And that's an integral part of how this river and its riparian system function. One of the things that we're also looking at is doing remote sensing of thermal and thermal regime. And this is a high-resolution image, and laid across the surface of this image, and what you see here is a stream coming in. Over here, this is a tributary stream coming into the main Flathead River. And this is a thermal image that is now georectified and laid over the top of that particular high-resolution image. What you'll see is tremendous amount of variation in the thermal regime of the particular river. So we have within 200 meters of stream length, we have a tributary stream coming in that's around 12 degrees C. We have groundwater upwelling that is bringing the surface temperatures. Okay. And then we have the main channel here runs around on this particular image, or at this particular moment when this image was taken, at 16 degrees C, with off-channel habitats, backwaters, reaching as high as 22 degrees C. So within this small, relatively small area of Flathead River, tributary river, and groundwater upwelling zones, we have a range in temperatures between 7 and 22 degrees C. What this does is it underscores the importance of that groundwater surface water interaction and mixing. And as groundwater that's part of a hyperreic zone, so it's water that has actually come from the river, penetrated into the alluvial aquifer, and then returns back to the river. As it's going through that process, it is being cooled, and as it returns back to the surface, is providing aquatic refugia to everything from aquatic insects to fish, and providing also preferred sites for spawning by bull trout and cutthroat trout. With that, I'm going to turn the next series over to Clint, and then I'll come back at the end as we get into the questions and answers. So here's Clint Muhlfeld.
Well, thanks for everyone for coming today. I'm going to talk now about our recent research in the Transboundary Flathead, which is recognized as a regional and range-wide stronghold for a variety of aquatic species, including bull trout, cutthroat trout, and lednia. We've got a host of aquatic habitat that extends from wilderness and complexes in the headwaters in Waterton International Peace Park, providing a variety of riverine, stream, brooks, and large lake systems that these species have evolved in for over 14,000 years since the last glacial period. We've got a host of biodiversity that's really unmatched elsewhere in North America, from our aquatic invertebrates, which I'll talk about a little bit today, as well as bull trout, which were listed as a threatened species under the ESA in 1998 due to habitat degradation, fragmentation, and invasive species. Bull trout have persisted in this drainage for thousands of years, are largely migratory populations, which move up to 250 kilometers from Flathead Lake and other large lake basins in the region, spawn in natal streams. The juveniles rear 1 to 4 years before leaving their natal stream and going to the large river and lakes where they grow to maturity and complete their life cycle. And so this interconnected habitat mosaic that Rick discussed is really critical. The whole entire interconnected system is critical for the persistence of bull trout that use the entire contiguous portions of this watershed. It's also recognized as a range-wide stronghold for non-hybridized West Slope cutthroat trout. Currently, throughout the range of cutthroat, less than 10% of the existing populations are genetically pure. And so the Flathead, on the other hand, holds some of the last remaining non-hybridized populations throughout this species range, and it's considered a species of special concern throughout its range in the U.S. We've also got more rare and endemic species of aquatic invertebrates like the alpine meltwater stonefly, Lednia tumana. Lednia tumana has recently been petitioned to be listed under the Endangered Species Act due to climate change-induced glacier loss. And so part of our research is better understanding the response of these alpine ecosystems and the invertebrates that occupy these longitudinal gradients from these melting glacier and permanent snowpack regions all the way down to the valley bottoms where the bull trout and cutthroat roam. Despite being recognized as a range-wide and regional stronghold for these species, however, habitat degradation and invasive species pose a serious risk to these species, and our research has really been applied to deal with these kind of management issues to better manage our native species for future generations. And one major factor that's likely to compound these existing stressors of habitat loss and invasive species is climate change. And this landscape is undergoing tremendous change right now. The warmer air temperatures that have been monitored throughout the western U.S. have resulted in a declining snowpack, increasing fire regime in many of these basins, as well as an altered hydrologic regime. This warming has posed serious challenges to native species like bull trout due to midwinter flooding, summer flow reductions, which actually increase water temperatures in a lot of these basins. The invasive nature of non-native trout might benefit from this altered landscape, as well as documentation of post fire debris flows and fires throughout each of these basins within the Flathead. And so part of my research is actually focused on a larger project working with a variety of folks throughout the West and looking at the composite risk of different climate change factors on the persistence of 12 different native salmonids throughout the Intermountain West. And we're looking at these composite change risks for species like the West Lobe cutthroat trout, shown in the northern part of this slide. But basically what that research has shown that it's been useful to prioritize conservation in high-risk areas across species ranges. However, if you're a manager or research specialist in certain areas within these drainages, you really want to know what's happening in the watershed that you're working in or the stream you're working in, and how these climate change impacts might change the habitat and thus the species assemblages that we're observing throughout the environment. So basically what we've been developing are high-resolution fine-scale models within the Flathead that we plan on expanding out to the entire crown of the continent ecosystem. And then these data will also be helpful in applying some of these techniques elsewhere throughout the Great Northern Landscape Conservation Cooperative. Our models consist of a series of submodels dealing with hydrology, stream temperature, wildfire, and invasive species, and to see how these synergistically influence the availability of suitable habitat for a variety of biota, assemblages of biota, as well as different life history stages. But first, we wanted to look back in the past as a prelude to the future and understand how this system is changing. So our first attempt at this was Greg Peterson led an effort to analyze over 100 years of weather station information in western Montana. And basically, over this 100-year record, we're seeing about a loss of about a month of extremely cold days, a threefold increase in extremely hot days. And these changes in temperature are tracking the global trends. But the kicker is that these trends are occurring at two times the rate of the global mean air temperature increase throughout the world. And so this system is truly undergoing rapid change. And so we need applied research to inform conservation and management and how to deal with this change so these species can persist into the future. And what's iconic story in global change ecology is the loss of glaciers in Glacier National Park. At the end of the last little life stage in 1850, there was an estimated 150 glaciers in Glacier National Park. Now there are only 25 left, and Dan Fagree's climate models predict that all these will be gone by the year 2030. So we wanted to understand how some of these flow and temperature regimes have been changing throughout the last 50 to 30 years. So you see here a chart of the summer-based discharge in the Flathead, and this is consistent elsewhere, but we're seeing about a decrease of about 3.7% in summer-based flows over just a 30-year period of record there. This shows positive values indicating increasing stream flows and negative values indicating decreasing stream flows for the period of record from 1958 to 2007. And as you can see here on the shoulder months of the winter period, primarily in November and March and April, we're seeing increasing flows in the watershed. So basically the snow is converting to rain and causing increased rain on snow events in the valley. In contrast, we're seeing decreasing flows in the summer months. And we're seeing a shift in the peak meltout. We're seeing an earlier peak discharge of about 2 to 3 weeks on average, as well as a decreased peak discharge, which is thus increasing the number of degree days that the streams are extremely hot. And with periods of drought, this elevates stream temperatures in the region. And you can see here, this spike on the right is showing an increase rain on snow event that occurred in 2006 in the outlet of Lake McDonald that actually matched the peak flow event the preceding spring. So today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about our temperature results over the last year. And we capitalized an existing temperature sensor network that I've been working on with a variety of agencies across the basin. And this spans different geographic and physiographic areas of the system, try to basically capture the variation in thermal regimes across the stream networks. And then we can develop high-resolution, spatially explicit models to try to predict changes in stream temperatures and how that might influence, in turn, the species of interest in our study area. And so one case history, talking about invasives now, is hybridization with introduced rainbow trout. So West Slope cutthroat trout is a native species here in the Flathead, a readily interbreed and produce hybrid swarms with introduced rainbow trout. And this is occurring pretty rapidly over a short period of time. Back in the early 80s, a lot of the sites that we took genetic samples came back clean. They contain non-hybridized sites, which is a couple sites with very low levels of less than 2%. As you increase in time to the early 2000s, you can see that hybridizations rapidly spread over just a couple generations of fish, indicating that it's rapidly spreading, and we wanted to identify the factors associated with the spread of hybridization. But the really interesting thing from a climate change perspective is that all of our currents and density models explaining the spread of hybridization in the system indicated that stream temperature is a key component related to the spread of hybridization in the system. And so our first take at developing stream temperature models just focused on using an ordinary least squares approach to try to retrospectively predict the thermal regime pre-hybridization and post-hybridization using a variety of predictor variables. So based on the air temperature effect that's in our model, we could then backcast to 1978 and predict what portions of the stream network exceeded this 90-degree mean summer water temperature threshold. That threshold, based on our logistic and multiple regression models, was basically the tipping point over which hybridization occurred. So as you can see here, prior to hybridization, that critical temperature threshold was only exceeded in some of the streams in the lower portion of the valley. The West Slope cutthroat trout hybridization studies indicated they were relatively non-hybridized. If we fast forward now to the mid-2000s, you can see that our temperature model predicted that an increase in stream temperatures exceeding the 9 degrees as they move forward up the drainage and covering a larger spatial extent. With that came the onset of wildfires. Approximately 16% of the valley burned in the last 30 years, as you can see in the yellow shaded areas there. And so what we wanted to do is just overlay the degree of the distribution of hybridization on these thermal and disturbance regime changes. And as you can see here, it matches it up pretty much to a T. So basically, the hybridizations rapidly spread in the system. And as long as those source populations are persisting in the valley, these hybrids are straying out, it will likely continue to spread if temperatures continue to rise and we see some of these disturbance events. We're conducting higher resolution models now to be able to look at that more closely. What that brings for the future, who knows? But the concern that we have based on our recent genetics evaluation of a recent hybrid swarm is that hybridization associated with introduced rainbow trout causes a severe fitness penalty. So it rapidly reduces fitness in later generation hybrids, suggesting that the resiliency of these populations might be compromised already if hybridization persists. And that's really of conservation concern for species like cutthroat trout that, are undergoing, the systems that they occupy now are undergoing tremendous change. We want to reduce these existing stressors and allow them to adapt and persist in the future. Now I'm going to change gears and talk a little bit about more of our spatial approach to understanding the thermal regime throughout the basin. We assembled all the temperature information and looking at summer metrics that are physiological thresholds for different species. And as you can see here on the left, as we move from an ordinary least squares regression approach, we're only explaining a small proportion of the variation in stream temperatures across this network, which extends both east and west of the divide in this situation. As we move up to different spatially explicit models, we're explaining much more of the variation in this, in temperatures across the basin. And what I'll be presenting to you today is this generalized linear mix model, which includes Hug-Stix as a grouping effect. So it's basically the best performing hierarchical model that we found to be useful to predict mean summer water temperatures throughout this basin. So here's the model that I'll be showing you today, having the fixed effects of things you would, you know, expect in some of these temperature models, like elevation, having a lake effect, solar radiation, mean air, and then east and west side of the continental divide. And so as an application of this model, we wanted to better understand how increases in air temperatures and increases in stream temperatures might affect critical habitat for threatened bull trout. So we digitized the existing spawning and rearing habitats as shown in red here, as well as the foraging, migrating, and overwintering habitats shown in tan. And we wanted to understand how temperature regimes might change the suitability of these different habitats. And so what we did is we ran a mean decadal model using that same stream temperature model that I just showed you, and modeled the foraging, migrating, overwintering thermal regimes in the last decade, as well as the spawning and rearing habitats. And as you can see here, about over 95% of the observations in FMO habitats included portions of the system less than 15 degrees on average. And in contrast, for the spawning and rearing streams, 85% of the values were at or less than 13 degrees Celsius. So we wanted to use those two trigger points to understand how thermal regimes might change the suitability of those habitats. So as an example here, and this is just a hypothetical scenario for just to go through what a potential application of this process, is here we have all the spawning and rearing habitats that our model predicts that might be suitable in tan under that 13 degrees Celsius threshold. As you can see, there's a little over 500 miles of suitable habitat based on that best model prediction. As we ratchet up air temperatures by 4 degrees, you can see that we potentially lose about 40% of that critical spawning and rearing habitat, which, mind you, is really, bull trout are one of the most cold water dependent species in the Pacific Northwest. So they really require cold water for, you know, their growth and survival. And so as we ratchet up stream temperatures here under hypothetical climate change scenarios, you can see a loss of up to 59% of the thermally suitable habitat and spawning and rearing sites throughout the basin. And if we increase it to up to 80%. This fish is now gasping for oxygen here on the left because there's nothing left. So for the FMO habitat, we can also look at once these fish, you know, rear in their natal streams 1 to 4 years, then leave, and enter these big river systems, and we can better understand what the thermal regimes might be under different scenarios. So right here under our base, we have about 650 miles of suitable habitat predicted by our model. If we increase air temperatures by 4 degrees, we see a loss of about 26%. If we increase it 6 degrees, a loss of about 42%. And then 8 degrees, a loss of about 57%. And so this is going to be really key for understanding where habitats might change throughout different life stages of bull trout and other species like cutthroat trout and the aquatic invertebrates that we're studying. And we have climate change information from Steve Hostetler that will feed in these and project out these different climate change scenarios. And then we can basically drill down with Rick's work on the high-resolution thermal imaging. We can really do bring to the table a multi-spatial scale approach to understanding the thermal regime shifts that we might expect, because these bull trout are really keying into areas of groundwater upwelling, like Rick talked about, which are basically biological hotspots. So this multi-spatial scale approach is, I think, going to be really key for species like bull trout. We're also understanding, I've got a graduate student looking at the geomorphic and hyperreic responses of climate change on some of these critical spawning and rearing sites for bull trout. And we're also studying other less charismatic species, micro-charismatic species like Aletnia stonefly that was recently petitioned for the ESA. This species is endemic to Glacier National Park, so it's found nowhere else in the world. It was petitioned to be listed because of the climate change-induced glacier loss. So we compiled over 14 years of information, including intensive surveys last summer, to document the distribution of this endemic species. And we found it occurring at over about 35 sites in the watershed, 86% of which were below glaciers in permanent snowpack, whereas 14% were found within springs. So this is a classic blue ribbon stream for Aletnia, and this is the Lunch Creek Basin up at the crown, at the tippy top of the continental divide in Waterton Glacier International Peace Park, just to give you a perspective there. I don't think my animation is going to work here, but it basically shows that these species have a strong thermal preference within these alpine areas. So they're occupying very short segments of stream, on average about 500 meters. They're highly correlated to distance to snow and ice. So as you go down the longitudinal profile of the stream system, you tend to lose Aletnia over just short distance. And as you can see here with the mean summer temperatures in red, there's a strong correlation in density of L. tumana with increasing, a negative association with increasing stream temperatures. And we also found that there, we didn't find them above mean temperatures of about 10 degrees and maximums of about 18 degrees. And we found a negative correlation with the diurnal flux in these alpine zones, which are totally exposed to the solar radiation throughout the day and then cool down at night. Some of these streams are changing up to 14 degrees a day. So with that, we wanted to basically use a maximum entropy approach to better understand the potential distribution of Aletnia throughout the watershed. So we used layers like snow and ice, elevation, gradient, topography, et cetera, to try to develop a predictive model to look at the potential distribution of this endemic stonefly throughout Waterton Glacier International Peace Park. And as you can see here, our best model results indicated that the highest probability of occurrences of L. tumana might occur in about 23 million meter squares of habitats throughout the Waterton Glacier International Peace Park. If we impose a climate change scenario of total glacier loss, which is predicted by 2030, and actually Dan Fagery has data now that suggests it might even be earlier, what would potentially happen to the distribution of this endemic stonefly? Well, we could see a potential reduction of up to 81% of their suitable habitat. So it's these rare, enigmatic aquatic invertebrates in these alpine zones that might be some of the first species to go under climate change in these mountainous landscapes. So we're also looking at the connectivity of different populations and species. And we're working with Aaron Landgoot and Gordon Lucart, both from University of Montana, developing a riverscape model to look at how different resistance gradients like climate change effects will affect the genetic diversity of different populations of Aletnia or species like the bull trout, which are highly divergent among streams. So we can get a better idea of how climate change might influence genetic diversity and long-term persistence. We're also trying to gain a better understanding of the physiological thresholds that these species might be able to deal with. And so we've collaborated with Dr. Molly Webb and Kevin Kappenman from the Fish and Wildlife Service at the Bozeman Fish Tech Center, who have a natural living stream that we can use to do some tests on changes in flow and temperature for species where these thermal regimes and tolerances are less understood, like species of Aletnia. So we can bring them into the lab and do controlled experiments to try to contrast to our field experiment. And so in summary, we believe that the for the crown of the continent, the transboundary flathead, and the greater Great Northern landscape, we need to be thinking about these regional assessments of aquatic species vulnerabilities and responses to climate change. That's really the heart of our research program now. And so what we aim to do is continue our work on assessing the vulnerability of the different native and non-native aquatic biota using an ecosystem approach from these alpine zones above the tree line all the way down to the valley bottoms where the bull trout and cutthroat persist. We also want to advance our spatially explicit temperature and flow models and developing monitoring programs to understand these changes throughout this highly diverse ecosystem. We're also working on models to better forecast non-native species invasions so we can predict where they might occur, so we can implement proactive conservation and recovery programs to deal with them now rather than when they're established. And we're also developing models to predict how changes in climate might affect this connectivity through low-dick systems, which is really hasn't been done to my knowledge in interconnected fluvial systems, and understanding how those changes might affect genetic diversity. And basically, for conservation and management, I mean, these species like the bull trout, which require cold, complex, and connected habitats for their persistence, you know, from the headwaters all the way down to the lakes, and we've got species of lednia occupying these strong thermal and hydrologic gradients in the alpine zone. It's basically back to the basics here. We got to deal with existing stressors like invasive species and habitat loss to try to build up resiliency in native populations and allow them to adapt into the future as they have for thousands of years before humans were on the landscape. And so with that, concludes our slideshow. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you, Clint and Rick. And now we'll open up the floor for people who might have questions for you.
Hi, my name is Venkat Sridhar, and I'm calling from Boise, Idaho. It was a very nice presentation. Can you hear me? Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Go ahead.
Yeah. Actually, I would like to know about the hydrology of this basin. What kind of changes in stream flows, especially low flows, are you looking at, and what kind of shift you are seeing with peak flows?
This is a classic snow melt driven system.
Yeah.
So that the peak runoff generally occurs sometime in May or very early June, and that is driven by different climatic regime or weather systems of a particular year, how warm it gets, how rapidly it warms, whether there's any persisting snow that then later gets a rain on snow event. All of the really large years or where there's a very high maximum discharge in a year, or the top 5 to 10 discharges on record going back to 1911 have been driven by rain on snow events. And so one of our concerns is that with a change in climate, we may see not only the peak in runoff occurring earlier, we may also see an increase in the amount of rain on snow events that increases the flashiness. Along with that, there come several things. One is that there may be an increase in the amount of cut and fill alluviation taking place in the rivers, and a change in the type of habitats that have been used for the last 10,000 years under which these particular species have most recently evolved. I recall you asked one question there about what are the base flows. The base flows run, in the North Fork, a typical base flow is around 800 cubic feet per second. A maximum flow typically is between 20 and 30,000 cubic feet per second. And I think the all-time high in the North Fork is around 70 to 80,000 cubic feet per second. In the Middle Fork, the all-time high is 120,000 cubic feet per second. That was in the 1964 flood.
Okay, yeah, thanks a lot. And I'm sorry, probably I may have missed this part when you mentioned about climate change assessments on what kind of models are you using in your study, climate change, climate model in the future. You presented a hypothetical climate change, temperature increased and so on, but what about the actual physical model, climate model?
Well, we haven't begun to force our models with climate data. We are working with Steve Hostetler with the USGS in Corvallis, Oregon, and he just came out with some high-resolution climate data that's actually available on the USGS website. So you can go there and visit his webpage and learn more about the different models that he's put together in this area, actually for the whole U.S.
Oh, okay.
It's going to be our first step in understanding the potential changes in the future. Just
okay.
One other point about the changes in the hydrology, those changes, we've seen the most pronounced changes occurring during the fall and winter period. And we've seen an increase in rain on snow events like I showed in that one slide. And that might be real problematic for species like bull trout that spawn in the fall during, real base flows. So part of our high-resolution modeling is actually looking at how those spikes in the hydrograph might affect the scour potential of those different spawning beds that are located on these upwelling, groundwater upwelling zones in these alluvial valley bottoms.
Sure. Thanks. And I just have one more quick comment for future seminars. If it's possible to circulate the presentation slides, we were actually listening to your conversation through the speakerphone, but I didn't get to see any of your slides. In the future, I think it might help really if somebody is presenting through webinars.
Yes.
You might want to contact the Great Northern LCC and talk to Susanna about how to get on in the future. There's actually software to be downloaded, and you can then participate by actually seeing the presentation coming up on your screen.
Yes, that's right, Rick, and we are also hoping to have this presentation on our website with the audio streamed so that you will be able to access it at a later date, but there was a way that you could do that. And if you'd like to contact me, I'll put you on our listserv so you know about future presentations.
That's a great idea, Susanna, having the audio distributed along with the presentation. Fantastic idea.
Do we have any other questions for Rick and Clint?
This is Doreen McCoy in Boise. Analyze for any other metals? It looked like it was just nitrate.
Yeah, we sure did. We conducted a whole suite analysis looking at, in addition to nitrogen, we also looked at, or nitrate, we also looked at ammonia and phosphorus and soluble reactive phosphorus total. We also looked at metals, both metals that are dissolved and transported in the stream, as well as metals associated with fine sediments that accumulate along the sides of the streams during the base flow. All of those analyses included not only mercury, but a full suite of heavy metals as well as lighter cations.
Did you also look at the whole fish community, or just were you focusing on cutthroat and bull trout?
With those assessments in the North Fork, BC, we did do community assessments, and largely the species, it's confined to just a couple different key species like bull trout, cutthroat, mountain whitefish, and the Rocky Mountain sculpin, and actually we might even have a unique subspecies or species of sculpin in the Flathead. And so those are the species that we have data on throughout the whole interconnected system.
Yeah, we found in the Northern Rockies, we found quite a impact on sculpin, especially. Very sensitive to metals, so that's why I was curious.
Yeah, right on. Do you have anything specifically what the sensitivity is to selenium?
Only that selenium may be associated with other toxic, other metals.
Yeah. One of the things that rather surprised us is that the two primary metals that come out as being significantly altered were selenium, and I think it was copper, which was kind of a surprise, but it might be specifically associated with some of the overburden sites in the Elk River Valley. And the copper didn't change anywhere near as much as what the selenium did. Selenium, for some reason, is really being released in the coal mine seam.
And other researchers have found higher levels of selenium in the West Slope Cutthroat in the Elk River.
Yeah, the various toxicity studies have shown that selenium values that get as high as 7 ppb and above start directly affecting natal growth of vertebrates. And of course, in this case, it's going to be cutthroat and the bull trout.
Hey Rick, this is Gary Tabor in Bozeman. Have you given this?
How you doing?
Good. Have you given this presentation in Fernie or Sparwood? I'm just wondering how they responded above the border.
Yeah, I have given it, and I have not given it to a general public. I've given it to professionals and NGOs, crown managers. There's a Crown Managers Partnership group, which is made up of the heads of the various agencies on both sides of the border, and they meet a couple times a year. I've given the presentation to them, and it has caused a fair amount of concern, a great deal of consternation, actually, but it has not gotten to the general public, and I would like to see it get to them, because they have a water quality problem that they've been in denial over for a long time.
That actually, the Elk is connected to the Upper Kootenai, which is another transboundary system in the U.S. Canada area, actually just to the west of the Flathead, and some of the strongest migratory adfluvial populations of bull trout spawn in systems like the wigwam that are directly downstream of the Elk. So there's concern in that transboundary system as well.
Anybody else out there with a question? Well, with that, I would really like to thank Clint and Rick for doing our inaugural LCC, GNLCC webinar series, and thank you all for joining us, and we look forward to having you on these in the future. Our next one will be in March, and we'll send out an email about that in the future here to come.
Okay, and thank you, Susanna, for your hosting this.
No problem.
Thanks all for attending. Appreciate your input. Bye.